there's a need for cleansing. Jesus is teaching a present example. You need to have your feet washed. There needs to be cleansing. But the second thing we see in the story is there's the neglected cleansing. We don't know if he washed Peter's feet first or tried to wash Peter's feet first, but here's what we do know. We know that when he came to Peter, Peter said in verse number 8, "No," Peter protested, "you will never, ever wash my feet." That's why I use the New Living Translation, because it's worded correctly from the Greek. "No," Peter protested, "you will never, ever." Notice he didn't just say never, as the older translations. "You will never, ever wash my feet." You get the emphasis there. What did he do? I need to tell you about the Bible. It's a wonderful book.
Amen.
I got to tell you something else. It's a perfect book.
Amen.
The men who were used to write it weren't perfect, but the God who wrote it is.
Amen.
And he didn't leave anything out. But one of the things that is important when you study any gospel is to study it in its synoptic context. One of the things you learn if you study the book of John thoroughly is that John had one goal, and that was to present Jesus Christ to the world as God. That was what he wanted to do, and so he leaves out a lot of detail. But where he leaves out detail, Mark and Dr. Luke fill in the blanks. That's why I gave you Mark chapter 10. And describe the egos of James and John. They're at the table. Jesus is going to wash their feet. But when it comes to Peter, whether he was first or not, the point is, when it comes to Peter, Peter says, "No, Lord, you will," he protested, "you will never, ever wash my feet." The neglected. The only way to understand this is to study it synoptically and understand what the disciples brought to the table. It doesn't make sense until you understand what they brought to the table. So what did they bring to the table? Synoptically, we studied synoptically, they brought controversy. When they came to eat the Passover with the Lord, the controversy was still going on. James and John started it. When you read the account, now what they said to Jesus, the disciples were set in their presence. And it says it really irked them to hear what those guys said. But we have to know and understand that Peter is guilty too, because he didn't want Jesus to wash his feet. There's an awful lot of pride there. So we go to Dr. Luke's account in chapter 22 of Luke. And in verse 24 we discover what the controversy is. Guess what it was? It was a discussion, a debate that led to a controversy over which of them was going to be the greatest in the kingdom that Jesus was going to establish. Who's going to be number one? Isn't that the center of all controversy today?
Amen.
Who's going to be number one? That college football ranking thing, they're never going to fix that. You know why? Because there's really not number one. They're all so good that they make it to those finals. On any given day, it's like the NFL. Any one of those teams can beat the other. There's really no number one. There's those who think they are. Just like in the church.
Amen.
Remember early on, I asked you one day to say, "I'm number two." Would you do that again? Say, "I'm number two."
I'm number two.
Is that hard to say? That kind of breaks the face. So Peter, I think, is leading the controversy. Back in Texas, where I come from, they say the guilty dog always barks first. And he always barks the loudest. "No, Lord," he protested, "you will never, ever wash my feet." The neglect. We have to understand what the disciples brought to the table, the controversy, but we also need to understand what Jesus is doing. What I love about the Word is you study it over through the ministry of Jesus. He was the master of every moment, and he knew the hearts of every person. He was never caught by surprise. He never lost face. And he never allowed himself to be trapped until it was time. And that's what this scene is all about. You see, Jesus is seizing a moment to teach a lesson for history, even for you and me, that works divinely and supernaturally. And he also seizes the moment. The master that he is, to resolve a dispute. Then we see the necessity of it. I love what Jesus said to Peter. We know Peter, the impetuous guy, right? Every time he opened his mouth, he inserted his foot. I heard one preacher refer to, or one writer refer to him as a disciple with a foot-shaped mouth. Lord, I'll follow you wherever you go. Remember that? Who was the one guy that didn't get out of the boat and start walking to Jesus until he took his eyes off Jesus? Put him on the storm and on the water. Let's give him credit, he got out of the boat, but he was awfully impetuous. And we're learning here that he's extremely prideful. Jesus makes a great statement here. You need to get this or you'll miss the whole thing. He says, Peter, unless I wash your feet, you don't belong. What you got to understand here about these 12 men, one to nine is in the story here, is that they're not full-blown believers. They didn't get this until after the cross and the resurrection. Don't fool yourself. Don't be fooled. If anything, they're like half believers. Their conduct, their response, their character, everything indicates these guys don't know yet what that means to follow Jesus. So there's a real imperative here. He says, Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you don't belong to me. You will not belong. Now let's kind of read between the lines. Jesus is saying to Peter, in earshot of all these disciples, Peter, understand something. I'm headed to a new assignment. I'm wrapping it up here on earth, and I'm going to be going away. He says that all through these passages in John. In fact, John chapter 13, all through John chapter 17, are what we call the death discourse of Jesus. This is where he not only talks about his death, plans his own funeral. Because he knew exactly when he was going to die. So he says, Peter, look, you've got to understand something. I'm wrapping things up here on earth. I'm headed to a new assignment. I'm departing earth. I'm no longer going to be doing an in-flesh ministry here on this planet. And I'm going to die in a way that you guys will understand.